So.
It's okay now.
It's online.
Yeah.
Okay, so I start my course as Professor Kuksin. I also give four lectures on control theory, actually. It will be introductory course in geometric control theory. And not very formal. It is not, I will not speak about really new things. And I consider this course, the actual goal is to explain some basic geometric ideas with minimal analytic techniques, because data could be useful, and already were useful, proved to be useful, and I believe some part of these ideas already proved to be useful for mixing, for evolutionary PDEs perturbed by stochastic. With stochastic perturbations, and I believe that also something else will be used in future. And so I start just with definition. What is control system? Control system is a simple thing. You have an evolution PD or differential equation. I will work with ODEs, but as it was seen in Professor Kuksin course. Actually, you can think about evolution PDEs as ODEs in the more complicated space. So you know, geometry does not change. If you consider all in, ODEs in all dimensions, it's more or less the same geometry as PDEs, but much more analysis is needed, more efforts to give regularity, much more efforts to give regularity, some good properties, in particular mixing. But geometry is essentially the same. It is already shown that actually for important nonlinear PDEs, it works, can be applied. Okay, but I deal with ODEs, so I consider the system. I start with very general, that I be a little bit less general. General control system is like that. You have just dynamical system. X belong to M. Since I do things geometrically, for me it's convenient that M is a smooth manifold. But if you are not very confident, some of you are not very confident with manifold, you can think that this is just domain in Rn. Okay? F of x, yes, let me write it better. I'm sorry, f of x is dynamical systems, ODE, if you want. And control system is formally, this is a family of dynamical systems which depend on some control parameter u. For me, u will be open, but a big part of control system, or just a vector space. But for because that what is used for mixing, and but in general it can be also nonlinear, and u can be a more complicated space, closed, some manifold with boundary, with corners, and even more complicated. Okay, so this is just a family of dynamical system parameterized by some parameters. We assume that it's everything is smooth with respect to x, and normally it's sufficient, it is continuous with respect to u. But actually, mostly in my course, I will consider just a fine dependence on u. Okay? Special case, fu of x is f0 of x. Main case for our course and for applications. Okay, and u is just, u belong to, say, Rk. So what we have here? We have some dynamics, and that is perturbed by other dynamics. Okay, so UI parameters of perturbation. So this is why we do special theory, we write many books, if it is just it's included completely in such a setting in the theory of dynamical system, because you have X which moves and U which that does not move. And that's all, okay? U is parameter. But it is not actually in control theory. What we do, we can treat U as control. So it is parameter that we can choose as we want and change us our choice at every moment of time. That's the point, okay? So this for us are control parameters and control functions. Functions. As I already thought, I will not give many analytic details here. You can find it in the book. The main source, I don't know, it's appeared in the website or not, where main source where everything is precisely defined and proved is a book Agarachev Sachkov Control Theory from the Geometric Viewpoint. Theory. From the geometric viewpoint. It's the Springer 2004. And there is also good collection of lecture notes. Here is in ICTP, if I understand it, they're totally free. Maybe they have even printed copies, I don't know. From the school we organized here some years ago, that's the mathematical control theory. Control theory. Two volumes, actually, there are a lot of courses. Control theory, ICTP lecture notes, so it's most simple to find here. Lecture notes series. Okay, so that's the sources. Now, fine. Control, control functions are just functions say some segment or NR plus T U of T, the strategy of selecting parameters. So they, okay, U of T, where U of T belongs to U, and T normally time, T is time as usual in evolution equation, normally T is positive. And the class of these functions, usually, in many cases, it is convenient to consider measurable bound that sometime you wish to have more regularity, but measurable bound that are quite fine. And in the linear case, this L2, it's even more convenient. In general, it is not, they do not have, if we depend non-linearly on U, it's the map is not so well defined, has not well analytic properties, but in this case, so U of dot belongs to, is a class of L2, L infinity, it's always possible, no problem. And O L2 or other LP, so there could be versions. Now, what we do? So it's indeed unlikely the case of stochastic perturbations in control theory, in classical control theory, u of t is what we are totally free to choose as we want, okay? And the main object to study is actually the map. We can define the map, ft, family of maps that depend on parameter t, that we can, in order to so now what we do? We have our dynamics. Dynamics is something that is done by physical law, or I don't know, by, we have a dynamics, we have a dynamical system that depends on parameters, and we can control some parameters. That's the idea. We have a family of dynamical systems with some parameters, like a car, or like a human body also. We have a body that actually whose position depends on many, many parameters, and some of them we can control and move and change these parameters whenever we want. In certain limits that are indicated here. And so we simply plug in this u of t, we get the mapping control u of t. Instead of parameter u, we are writing u of t now. And then we have, under this setting, we have a well-posed evolution system. So Cauchy problem is in finite dimension is well posed, at least for small t, but that's details which I'll not care. Of course, solutions may blow up in some time, but this I will not care about. It's easy to control anyway, just to not to spend time for that. At least for any initial condition, x of zero, we have one defined solution. And let me, in order to minimize number of variables, to simplify formulas, just to fix. So in order to get a solution, we need to choose u of t and control function and the initial condition. I fixed initial condition. I just fixed initial condition. This is going to be fixed from the very beginning. And then I have the map, which I call family of map, which I call ft, that send u of dot into x of t u of dot. If I have u of dot, I have unique solution starting from here f0 is just of u of dot is just x0. I assume that the initial condition is fixed. We have a unique solution starting from x0, and we take it and evaluate at moment t. That's a map of t. It's actually the main object to study. It has a quite rich map, as I think you will see soon. What properties we are interested, first of all, of course, we are interested where we can arrive. We start from position x0. We can start with any position. But for the moment, I fixed it. And we select control. We move somehow. And the question is our control capacities, where we can arrive. So what we are interested, this is called controllability problem. To understand somehow the image of this map, where we can arrive. Let me also denote by u, this is going to be space of controls, this will be script u. U is a space of this function 2u of t. U of dot, admissible u of dot, okay? This value is in u capital. And fine, so that's what we try to study. And the controllability problem. Is it true? System is controllable, that f of u script is the whole manifold. Can we arrive everywhere or not? That's the first question. Ft for time t, controllability for time t, or for infinite time, then just t is free. Let me explain immediately, before specification, that even in so general setting, relation of this problem, it's actually problem that is a relation with a mixing. What people, so here everything is deterministic, no stochastic thing. And as I thought, we simply study, select any control that we know. But assume that we do not know how to select our control, and we have some probability distribution. Some probability distribution on U, and just apply with certain probability, according to certain probability distribution. Divide. Now I start to be closer to the setting of Professor Cooksin. We have a time segment, t. We divide it in small pieces. Or we may do more advanced things, consider a kind of divided limiting case, a kind of Brownian motion, a stochastic process with continuous time. But sufficient, totally sufficient to divide it in fixed. And we use just a piecewise constant control, say, even piecewise constant control, or some particular classes of controls. For piecewise constant constants that are distributed with respect to probability measure on U, some probability measure on U, okay? We apply it here, arrive to some point, then independently apply on the second segment, independently on third segment, independently on that segment, and we are interested. And then as a result, at time t, we will get not a point, but probability distribution, okay? We have such a random work, if you want, according to prescribed dynamics. And we obtain a probability distribution at the end, and we are interested in the properties, and mostly we are interested, does it have a limit for t equals to infinity, that limit that does not depend on x0, unique limit for t equals to x0. Usually it does not depend on x0. So I claim that there could be, and I think in Professor Cooksin lectures, at least in this papers that he mentioned, he used more sophisticated things. So they were not piecewise constants. So the probability distribution was defined on the space of U restricted to small segment, to the given segment, okay? So it's richer things. It's not piecewise constant, but important that you take a certain distribution of control in the space of controls on given segment, and then you repeat it, but totally independently. Crucial words here, independently, okay? And what will happen at the end of the day, or at the end of everything for t infinity? I claim that the mixing property is extremely close to the just controllability properties. If you do not take naive, not actually mathematical problem, that question is not mathematical question. So it's at the level of set. How normally, if we use some real tool to check this, you have more, because if you have a give a way to select a control which arrives at any point, it is not just you prove that it is the I explained this later in my course, you have really more. So what I mean, assume that we have a kind of qualified. I say, I claim that qualified controllability with some stability, some solid properties, is essentially equivalent to mixing, at least in finite dimension. In finite dimension, yes. Because in infinite dimension, we normally do not have, we never have this. In infinite dimension, we may expect only the closure of that. And it is a little bit other story, and you need much more analysis. You, in order to study the properties of the measure, you have to project it on finite dimensions, and it's more delicate, and you have you cannot do it in the universal way. You need a certain class of, it works for certain class, but important class of PDEs. But in finite dimensions, more or less, what I mean the qualified or solid controllability. Assume that we start from x0, okay, and at time t we arrive, and as soon as we have ux, so this is x of t of u tilde of dot, we arrived at some point using specific controls. We start from x0, this is a trajectory. This is a trajectory, and at time moment t, we arrived here, okay? Maybe I draw it in another part of the box, the blackboard, we have a huge blackboard, so let us use it. X0, we arrive to x1, x of t, u tilde of dot, okay? And assume that it is not, we have a bigger property, greater property. We assume that the map is, our map is open in point u tilde. Ft of some neighborhood of u tilde in the space of control functions covers some other neighborhood, say like that, of x1, okay? Assume that it is open, and moreover, the size of this, and assume that it is like that. So, essentially, normally not all neighborhood is necessary, since we have a finite dimensional manifold here. Here I start to use it, we are finite dimensional. We have a finite dimensional manifold of x. We can normally find a family. It's maybe not necessary the complete neighborhood by some finite dimensional family of controls near u tilde. Some perturbation of this control are sufficient. Okay, but assume we have this, and moreover, somehow we may control the signs. This guy may be much smaller than this white, but still with some minimal control, absolutely minimal control. Okay. And how it can be controlled? Very often, and I explain it in the next lecture, maybe even probably today, afternoon, very often, what I say, when I say qualified controllability, it means that if I perturb little bit f, then we still have this property, which maybe neighborhood becomes smaller, but we still have this property. So I do not only go to the point. First of all, I go to the neighborhood. I have a sufficiently rich. Somehow, this is the only way when you prove controllability, you automatically prove. There are no other way. You use analysis to prove controllability, okay? So using analysis, you automatically prove this property. But at least as finite dimensional, we can have more. If we have it is a stable in some, that property is stable. So if we perturb a little bit UF, or if you want, if U is a finite dimensional family. So you have U tilde, and you have some F tilde of dot, and you have some finite dimensional family. Of this is, can, you can take it as a neighborhood of U tilde. Not complete, it's too much normally. And if you perturb also this guy's little bit, and F little bit, you still cover a neighborhood. So this is what is called solid controllability, okay? Now look. Take a time, say, one. Now look what happens. Assume that we have it. It means that now switch to the stochastic situation. In stochastic situation, this property means that we cover small neighborhood with a non-zero probability. If you have a distribution such that all controls are presented somehow in this distribution, okay? Then we with maybe very small, extremely small, exponentially small size, has exponentially smaller size than this one, but still with non-zero probability, we can cover a neighborhood. It means exactly that. You can understand it. Because if you can use a family of a full probability. So, and if it is like that, switching is almost free in finite dimensional. Look, the independence comes in the gain. For time one, we do it, okay? And I'm sorry because, of course, now I see that when we do stochastic viewpoint, it is not convenient to use a fixed once forever initial condition, okay? So DCF actually depends also on X0, okay? Let us write like that. They play different rule. X0 and this play different rule, okay? And then what we do? Look, so we have time one now, two. Yes, but I say about initial condition. Initial condition, I cannot feel sick because I have a dynamics, I have a semigroups. When I go time one, then I start from the, then I continue going, I keep going, but start from another point. I start from the point where I arrived, okay? So this property has to be somehow homogeneous. Homogeneous with respect to X0, okay? That property, this property of X0. But it is, because indeed, that's what I say. We have something bigger, because if we take little bit X0, then it means that F change just little bit, okay? And if we have a forgiven X0, we have a qualified controllability, then we have a for any point, for any X0, okay? At least when we start from compact, we can cover by neighborhood and things like that, okay? We have qualified, the solid or qualified controllability, which I mentioned, implies that it works for any X0, okay? From a compact. So, look, now we understand that for any reasonable distribution of controls, we arrive to a point, if we really solve controllability problem, not just to claim something abstract non-checkable set theoretic that it is that the map is surjective. If we really prove it, we got this, then what happens? So we arrive to point with some very small probability starting from x0, we obtain x1, the small neighborhood of this, of x1, with very small probability, say, with probability mu distribution here is a mu of that that neighborhood, this one, is epsilon, very small. So very small probability, but still it is separated from zero. Probability to arrive to the to such a neighborhood. But then we continue, we repeat our game, starting from here, and let us look what happens. So if we arrive here with probability epsilon, it means that we do not arrive at mu of f to arrive in O of x0. And probability mu of the whole guy minus O is 1 minus epsilon, okay? Is little bit smaller than epsilon. But then we repeat our game, but we do it independently, okay? We do it independently. It means that for time two, we look the same neighborhood. For time one, do not come here is minus epsilon, yes, probability minus epsilon. Then do not come here for time one and for time two gives you, it's a time one. Time equals to one, time equals to two, that is a minus epsilon in square, okay? Just independence, okay? We do not arrive for time one and neither for time two. It's a product, okay? Then we continue for time equal n, it is minus epsilon in power n, okay? So what we see, that eventually this probability, if we keep going long time, but our idea to do it up to infinity, that probability not to come here is goes to zero. We absolutely, earlier or later, we come to this neighborhood. And if you have a controllability property, it means that we come to any neighborhood. Earlier or later, we come to any neighborhood and with some positive probability. And this is essentially almost all you need for mixing, if you come everywhere. Because look, we wait for the moment when we come here, but then still, even if it's very long time, still it is, we have infinite time ahead. So we repeat it, and the end, it is a quite classical in the Markov processes, Markov chain, that we everything is mixing. Due to that, first of all, we arrive everywhere that I already showed, but since we arrived everywhere still in finite time, we repeat this guy which travels everywhere infinite number of times, and at the end, everything is mixed. This is a basic property of Markov chain, at least in dimensional, finite dimension, it's okay. And infinite dimension, as I mentioned, the main problem is that we still simply do not have this. We do not have complete controllability because we have not enough resources. So that is, I would like probably exactly to start to explain why mixing at so close to control. And at the end of my course, I will not use absolutely stochastic language and mixing. This is remains to Professor Cooksin. And I will just study first this controllability problem, but not only. Actually, in particular, in finite dimensions, this normal controllability is enough. In infinite dimension, we have some intermediate step that finite dimensional projections, because only not solution itself, but only its finite dimensional projections may have this property. And then things starts to be more delicate, because when dimension grows, estimates become worse, and it starts to be very important not just to come here with some, but to come here in the best possible way. So, so here, optimal control problem comes in the gain, and I will discuss also optimal control. In this language, how I can explain optimal control questions. So, two basic questions of control theory is controllability and optimal control. Optimal control used for applications, used for in a lot of for many things, but let me explain how it appears here, why it is getting to be essential here, also in the poor words, not without any technique actually. Look, so as I already explained, the main thing is to understand that we come with some controls close. As soon as we arrived in some point with some controls close to this point, we cover a neighborhood. But then when it is only finite, if we actually need a family of that with growing and growing dimension, that property simply is not enough. It does not work. It again starts to be not applicable. And what we need? We need to cover it by, when I thought, I did not, for me it was all the same, which kind of control I used to cover the neighborhood, okay? And for applications to PDE, for me it's important that it is controller not big enough. It's well-described family, and that it is not so far from utility. Not so far from UT. It starts to be very important for estimate, okay? And for that, optimal control is useful. Essentially, what gives optimal control? Assume that we can get point x1 from x2. Point B from point A is in the high school. And then we have a cost to say if our control is good or not. And optimal control try to minimize simply the cost. Cost is maybe integral cost. In this situation, so we come U tilde sent us here. U tilde sent us here. Some U tilde, say, plus V sent us in the point nearby. Natural cost here in particular is integral of V square is just L2, or can be LP, on what we can really check, and in particular LP. And we try to minimize guy which sent us nearby, okay? And there is a good, we can characterize it's a kind of generalization of calculus of variations, so you can characterize extremals, so we have one point, another point, and we try to find the control, a corresponding trajectory, such that is cheap as possible, perturbation as cheap as possible. We can characterize it by some differential equation, so there is some calculus which extends classical calculus of variation, and this is actually optimal control theory. I also discuss about it, what can be done there. So this is what we plan to with, and now let me start. So as you see. The main hero here is the endpoint mapping, which is a quite rich. You see that it is not a dependent. depends on the family of dynamics or even dynamical systems, quite rich subject, but this one also. Let us consider, and I immediately, and at the beginning, to explain some basic things, and some maybe nice geometry, I restrict myself to the not even affine, but linear case. So I consider the situation when f u of x, so we do not have a dynamics with u control. When control is zero, we just stay. F u of x is just a sum of u I f I of x, okay? And here, the theorists are, no, and that, okay, so let's, we start at point x0, and we immediately would like to see where we can go, which direction we should go. Interesting things, also in control theory, it's what control theory is about, when dimension of M is k is much smaller, or just smaller, much smaller than dimension of M. If the dimension, if k is a dimension of M and Fi, let us assume linearly independent, locally at least, just for simplicity, that may be dependent at some point. And if dimensions are equal, then of course we can go in any direction, controllability is obvious, because Ui Fi give you, combination of Fi give you all kind of velocities, you go in any direction, everything is fantastically good. And interesting cases are when it is smaller, and in applications to PDE, interesting cases are when k is finite, but what I'd say, dimension of M may be much bigger, in PDEs it's infinite. It's still we can manage, we can do something, at least at finite dimensional projection. So k, okay, let us look where we go. Where we can go. Just write this equation. We use analysis, so let us use small control. F1 of x, put here epsilon. Put here epsilon. And one of F1 of epsilon u is x0 plus with small control, we can write a principal term. We can write a principal term and it will be, it's very clear. So if control is principal term, here is just average of fu of t of x0 dt plus o of it. So we can write like that. So this is x of t without any remainder term, but if you would like to develop, to extend it to, it's just rewriting ODE. What is here, it's a rewritten ODE. But still, we already have epsilon here, and X is epsilon closed, since velocity has size epsilon closed to original point, that we can write it, put here X zero of epsilon square. So as it was obvious, expected in the first approximation, we just go in the direction of linear hull of these guys. What I would like to mention here, that there are another way to do things. In particular, maybe there are two parameters here, time and size of controls. We may have with a not small control, but for small time. And obtain essentially the same. If we write U epsilon of t equals U of t epsilon, and this might be not small, then we get changing variables in ODE, we get more or less the same. Okay, so just rescaling time, I omit this calculations, we have the same, it could be epsilon U, what could be U epsilon of dot, and for time epsilon. Since, as I mentioned, we start to use the fact that we can select our controls as we want. We take U, then we rescale the same U, values of U of T, one after other, but go faster. Go faster, then at least in the first, not in the first approximation, then general, we have then F epsilon, I'm sorry. It's just the same. To go time one with guy U, or to go time epsilon with guy one, it's just the same, just rescaling. Okay, fine. So at first approximation, we do not have much, we have something trivial, but there is this something here. Now I give a first introduction for that part of this lecture. Okay, it's now 1/2 of the lecture. Then I start to be more precise. I will explain how things appear, but now I would like to have an example of result, simple result, but to demonstrate how the theory works. Okay, then I will develop it in more details. So what we go, it's average velocity, in direction of average velocity. But okay, but if average velocity is zero, let us consider U such that now assume that U of t dt is zero. So if average is not zero, just we move in the direction of average velocity, it's not so much. So, but clearly, we may expect much better other direction if in first approximation it simply don't move. Okay. Now, let me change a little bit notation, starts to be more geometric. What? Average of U. This is linearly depend on U. This is linearly depend on U. It is, yes. So if average of U is zero, then also average of F of U is zero. Because F is computed in one point, we go in the direction of average and the initial point. That's what we do, okay? In average of U, the idea is to study, to see some laws where we go in terms of U. So let me consider the curve gamma of T. It is just primitive of U of tau dot tau. Just primitive. So that property means that gamma is a closed curve. So gamma is not closed curve in the space of controls, okay? Moreover, now I would like to specify more because my idea now to show, not to have too dry lectures, to show something geometrically interesting. Rather simple, but geometrically interesting immediately. So Gao is not closed, so we go if f of gamma, then we go in the direction f of gamma of 1, okay? Because integral can be taken here. You can write this is gamma of 1 simply. Okay? Gamma of 1. And if gamma of 1 is 0, if the curve is closed, gamma of 0. And then where we go? I show you, it's a simple exercise that you can do even by yourself. Then where we go? Then I claim that it follows that f epsilon of u epsilon is we have to compute second term. That is quite easy here. Quite easy here. And this is a epsilon square. And this gamma since curve. Let me now specify, assume that K is 2. I would like to study just K of 2. But what I say, at this level, there is a nice generalization, but I will not much more notation of what I say what I'm going to say for any K. But let us assume that k equals to 2. Then what we have, so this is a plane curve. This is a plane curve, and this is a domain gamma. It covers domain gamma, okay? What I have here is a very simple exercise. I perhaps omit. We get an area of gamma multiplied by f1, f2 of f0 plus of epsilon cube. So we go slower, but we go in other direction. This is I should explain perhaps. So this is a Lie bracket. So f1, f2 in coordinates. f2 in coordinates, it's just df2. Over dx f1 minus df1 over dx f2 of x computed at point x0, computed at point x0. Okay, so these are what is called bracket or commutator of vector field. So we have something new if field do not commute. Maybe recall it will be very useful for me, also more formal definition of of commutator, why it is commutator actually. And again, I leave with you at this exercise. We may think f is a vector field. So at any point, we attach some velocities to go, okay? We normally think in all textbook and analysis, it's immediately explained that we can think about it as first order differential operator, okay? When we apply linear differential operator. This non-linear field is actually linear differential operator, which acts like that. If we have a smooth function, say C infinite of M, then fx on A, it's just definition, fx of A, fa is other function, is directional, is simply derivative of A in direction of x. Of x is a is a dxa f of x, okay? That we know. Then, since it is a linear operator, we can iterate it. We can write f1, f2a, just a composition operator. That is a second order operator. That is second order differential operator. We can also write f2, f1. This is another second order derivative. Clear that we first, when we apply f2, we get the first derivative of a, then for the result, we apply f1 for result, we have second derivative. Here we have also second derivative. But commutator, it is everyone knows, is again a vector field. is a gained vector field. It's not occasionally this disappears commutator. At the end, you see that nothing else could be appear here. Because since it is a, we have a, some expansion of some, we have f epsilon of epsilon, x a curve, it's a curve in M. Its expansion of the curve starts from x0. Okay? If it starts from the second term, this expansion, the second term is a, is a tangent vector. Okay? It must be tangent vector, and it's, it appears some, it's some combination of derivative of f1, f2. It's only one is this. You can expect it. You can expect it. So then f1, f2, it is actually, if you treat these guys as operators, it is f1. It's indeed commutator. F1, f2 minus f2, f2, f1. It is indeed commutator. So now let me erase something. So that's it. So it's unavoidably goes in this direction because it must be. It must be what appears here. First of all, what is written is universal expansion which does not depend on f. For any f, it is here. Okay. So. And even from here you obtained it should be something with a coefficient, with a coefficient. And the rather simple calculation shows that coefficient is exactly area of this guy. Exactly area of this guy. Okay, so, and let us continue our discussion plus epsilon square. And then, actually, maybe I say immediately that it cannot be area because it may have different signs, of course. It's signed area. So if you go in this, if you change orientation, exchange f1 and f2, then signs is changed, okay? Here and must be changed here. You do not change your problem, you just change notation, okay? Result must be the same. So this is a signed area. So this guy is oriented and it is a signed area. I do not remember immediately, it is a, perhaps it's oriented like that. If we, but could be opposite, but it is not important actually, up to sign. It's signed area. So in particular, if you have if your curve looks like that, so one, and you go in this direction starting from zero, say from here that this give you plus, and give oriented in the opposite way and give you minus, okay? For future, it is useful because we do not want to stay with second order. We would like to go further. We would like to go further. So it is signed area. And already we have something to do. If you would like to go, okay. We take absolutely any curve such that area is a positive, and you go here. If negative, it goes in the opposite. And you hold in the direction of bracket, that is totally can be totally independent. If vector fields are commute, then we do not gain anything, and even you keep calculation, you still do not go there. If the point is, and this is to think for you because it's also not so hard to exercise, if two vector fields commute, but it's obvious, then it's not important what where you go first, where you go next, if fields are commute, because you can exchange it. It means that the result, you know, the many things can be explained before calculation. The result depends only how long time you go along one, f1, and how long time you go along f2, and not of the sophisticated strategy. You can switch whatever you want. If vector fields are commute, nothing change. then essentially result depends only on average U. Because order give you everything, if they commute. And then we do not continue because we cannot. For control theory, it's just trivial case. It's not applicable. If they do not commute, it's applicable, and we immediately have. So any guy give you any curve like that give you movement, but coefficient is different. Coefficient depends on the domain, theory of the sign theory of the domain. And okay, of course. And in particular, we may try to go more. We would like to maximize this area, or say, assume that we would like to fix this area. We would like to go in the prescribed direction. Okay, we would like to go in the most economic way. If area is fixed, we would like to find U such that it is a shorter, such that the curve is shorter, okay? We have a link. To get this, we have many U. Shortest U to have this area. Shortest U we obtain if we consider solution of the isoperimetric problem. Okay? The area is fixed. That will be the most efficient control to go in the direction of F1, F2. We still go with all the epsilon square, but we can improve coefficient. That is also useful. So we would like to, it means that the isoperimetric problem is that you can formulate in two ways. We will try to minimize the length of this guy. Essentially, it means to minimize integral of U of t dt, minimize it, okay? Absolute value here of U of t, and to get given area. Or equivalently, we can fix the length, so we cannot go use we have some limits on the cost of control, we cannot go take a big one and try to go as far as possible in direction of U. So we maximize gamma with fixed length. It's the same problem. It's an isoperimetric problem. And you know very well the solution. Solution is a circle, okay? So if your gamma is circle, it gives you the best coefficient. And you can even, the standard thing to realize commutator is to take a square. Go first along one, along second, then back along one, back along second. It's worse in all sense. Worse than circle in all sense. First of all, coefficient is essentially 1/3, not exactly 1/3, but worse coefficient. And also your control is non-smooth, that is not good. So you should use circle. And this is still very simple. More interesting mathematically is the next case. Okay. Assume that how to get so we already know how to go in F1, F2, and even have efficient control. So if you can go that for time epsilon, we go here, then we can repeat it, and we know what to do. Simply make this gamma primitive of control, simply rotate like this, rotate, and this oscillation control gives you, essentially assume that if M is three-dimensional, that this is a F1, F2, and if we, and this is say F1, F2, extra direction. And when we, in control space, we just go around the circle, repeat in the circle, but in real space, since in control space, variables commuting, it's U1, U2, but in real space, we go here, and to go as fast as possible, we get a spiral like that. We go slow along the spiral. So that's a picture. very simple picture. And but already at this level, you know what actually my goal, part of my goal in this course. So we somehow, because this, that is important, that this the law of efficient movement is universal. It does not depend on the your vector fields. Okay, you find in the control space the best possible law, and then just plug in your system. Okay. So somehow the good control theory is done without control system. It must be. It should be. It's not yet done, by the way. It's maybe just a dream for the moment. Without control system. We simply then plug in any control system, and but laws of good behavior are always the same. If we do it on with small controls, or of course we need some small parameter to do it, or you do it for short time and then repeating. So, but now I would like to discuss also next case, again with k equals 2. This k equals 2. Next case. So assume that now that area of gamma is 0. So gamma is something like, let's say, balanced area. Plus, and here it's not really balanced, the picture, plus and minus. Balanced area. Then F. Then we can write some other expression of gamma that is not area, it's a kind of momentum. I will not give details. later. In fact, I can do it. In fact, I can do it. What we get here, what we obtain here. Without geometric interpretation, so nice in geometric interpretation is here, I do it. F epsilon of U epsilon. Then now, of course, starting point, and plus, again, you know, epsilon cube, again. Still, since now principal term is a cubic, that principal term is just tangent to your cube. Your curve, again, it starts from epsilon cube, but if you rescale, it change parameters, take epsilon cube as a new parameter, then it will have derivative. And derivative is a tangent vector, okay? You can take epsilon cube as a new parameter. Derivative is a tangent. It must be tangent vector. It must be value on some vector fields, and this vector field is cooked from F1, F2. No other way, because again, expansion is universal. F is just symbol. Expansion. And here you can write it. Okay, let me write. E1. Then you can interpret it also geometrically, that I will do. But what I'm writing now is a kind of expression which you can continue, you can write for any, it will be this similar for any order. And here you have this is T1, this is T2, so you integrate over the simplex. And here we get control, so I can write it in terms of gamma. F of gamma to 2 gamma u of to 2 or gamma dot of to 2, say, because the result depends at the end only on gamma. Result depends only on the gamma. Let me even write. Okay, right, like that. But you see that the result does not depend on the parameterization. That's what I would like to say. if different controls are just reparametrization of the same geometry is here also. Reparametrization of the same curve, that the result will be the same. Depends only on gamma, but not on its parametrization. Gamma of T2, F gamma dot of T of TO2, or gamma dot of TO1, F gamma dot of T D to 2 D to 1 DT. Okay. So to 2 is integrated until T2, to 1 is integrated until T1, and T is integrated until 1. Essentially, such a iterated integral that also, first of all, since we have a triple integral here and derivatives here, then indeed it does not depend on parametrization of gamma. And again, we at the end, what we obtain? At the end, we obtain a point in the plane. Let us now draw the plane. So we started in the situation with the span of F1, F2. F1, F2. And now let us draw the plane. We have second order brackets. And we have two second order brackets, actually. We have F1, F1, F2. Only two, because brackets are anti-symmetric, we have only two of them. F2, F2, F1. So here argument must be different because we are anti-symmetric and the first order bracket is just one, but here we have two. Okay? And we appear when we apply our control indicated by the curve gamma, we go in the direction of this plane. So we consider, say that this plane, we have an arbitrary dimension manifold, and in this manifold we have a kind of plane. I would like to show that it's not square on the plane, but it is some plane, which is not that one. It is already third order bracket. We have first order bracket, we know how to go, and you would like to go to next direction that depends already on the second derivative of F. It's the iterated bracket. So here, say we have two guys, F1, F1, F2, and another one, F2, F2, F1. All orientation is controlled. I will not give details because otherwise it takes too time and hard to follow also. I would like to explain just basic idea and result. So we have a plane of controls, commutative plane, if you want, U1, U2. And we have a linear map, call it AF, say, that send U1, U2 into U1, V1. It is other plane because it is not a V1. It's not control really. I use other way. V1, V1, F1, F1, F2, plus V2, F2. At this level, we have a more direction to move. In the first bracket, we F2, F2, F1. We gain just one direction. Here we have the whole plane. Okay? And to go in these directions, we apply gamma, we use gamma like that, with balanced area. The question is again the same. try to find universal law in the plane here, which gives you beta coefficient, which with the limited length of the curve give you best coefficients. You have a nice variational problem, universal problem, it doesn't depend on F, and it is not so classical, it is not an isoperimetric problem anymore. It's more nonlinear, more involved, and it can be solved, and the solution is so nice that you immediately try to continue, and it often happens in mathematics. If you go to the next, it starts to be too complicated. But at least at this level, in this level, you have a very nice solution. So you understand that it should be something like that, H-shape. Because if you have a more complicated guy, it cannot be best. It's H-shape. So you know, it's indeed H-shape, because we can rigorously solve this problem. It's indeed H-shape. What is, moreover, you see H-shapes, a kind of Gantel guys, are always done with the fact that we have two-dimensional results depends on the orientation. You can rotate it, okay? If you rotate it, you have one parametric family, but they're absolutely equivalent. One getting rotomazed from the rotated. It's not like circles that is rotation invariant. Due to the fact that it's rotation invariant, you get just one result. And here, and what is the best? The best is solution is the H-shape Euler-elastic. The unique best solution is H-shape Euler-elastic. Euler-elastics are invented, found by Euler, are equilibrium of elastic rod. It's in all textbooks on elastic theory, one of the very few, maybe unique one non-trivial example which can be computed up to the end. But they appear in other, very often appears in optimal control problems. Essentially, you see why, because as soon as you need a second order bracket, you need something like that, maybe a little bit sorted, but something like that. And they have a nice geometric characterization, actually, in order to not describe equation for elastic. They have very nice geometric. Gamma is elastic curves. Gamma in the plane elastic curve. I already thought that the result doesn't depend on parametrization. It's this property of the curve. If and only if curvature is a plane curve of gamma at point x is a fine function of coordinates. Okay? Curvature is a fine function of coordinates. So it's gamma is, say, v1 v2, and the curvature of gamma is alpha plus a1 gamma 1, I do not need to write this one. Curvature is alpha plus a gamma. Curvature gamma at any point of gamma, where a is a fixed vector, constant vector, and this is constant. So you see what happens. For first order bracket, just if there are no bracket, if we would like to go to the direction of linear Hall F1, F2, of course, we go, the best way to go along the straight line. Shortest way is straight line. So, and the solution is a curve with zero curvature, straight line. If you go to the second bracket, the first order bracket, the best way, then we need a closed curve. And the best way to take a curve with constant curvature, okay? Of course, they are all special in such a formulation, they are all special cases of Elastica. But degenerate, most degenerate. And if you would like to go to the direction of the third order bracket, then you already you use only gamma with a balanced area, and among them, the universal independently of F, the best one is the eight-shape Euler-elastic. Euler-elastic, there are a lot of them, but only two periodic, circle, of course, and this one. They have two types, without inflection points, it looks like that. Then, and with inflection points, it looks like that, and among them, there is exactly elastic. Here you find a circle when you do not move and always repeat as one of possibilities. And here you have eight, indeed, if it does not move. There are two types of elastic. They are related also to pendulum equation, and these are two. They are related to pendulum. So another characterization of elastic is that if you parameterize your curve by the length, so your velocity is always in the circle, has the absolute value one, then the curve is elastic if and only if this angle, direction of velocity, satisfy pendulum equation, standard pendulum equation. It's another characterization, classical characterization, one of the classical characterization. This is with particular parametrization. And No, non-linear. This is total. Mathematical pendulum. Theta dot this equation, where theta, this is a gamma dot, and this is angle theta, okay? Gamma dot, this is angle theta. And we have, for pendulum equation, we have two kinds of behavior. It may oscillate when velocity is small, or it will rotate. When it oscillates, according to the definition, this is the velocity change direction, so this is a second derivative change sign, and this is a second derivative change sign, and this family. And this family corresponds to rotation like that, with big velocity. Now that is what concerns elastic. My time is almost over. Maybe I have 5 minutes, somehow 5 minutes. Maybe I start. It was a preliminary part. So as I mentioned, but of course you immediately would like to continue, take other higher order brackets and consider curves such that curvature is a second order polynomial of coordinates. You can do it, but then you have a difference. You have much more higher order brackets than polynomials. The number of the dimension of Lie algebra, of universal Lie algebra, number of independent brackets grows much faster than the dimension of the polynomial spaces. Okay, so we have much more curves and very hard to follow. There is a very interesting relation between algebra, Lie algebra, and perhaps geometry of curves, but it is very complicated. Still, you can select particular family for particular brackets, for special brackets, which give you reasonable curves. In particular, these curves, they also start to be a bit complicated. These curves whose because this is an integrable system, you can do. But in the next step, you will have not integrable already. So geometry, explicit geometry, more or less finish here. On the other hand, if you consider k bigger than two, any k, but I'm interested only in the first order bracket, you have explicit solution, quite nice. It is written, analytically written in trigonometric function. It also is a complete characterization. And also these curves, the special curves are very, very, very clear. They form Chebyshev family, they have other extremal properties also. Other extremal properties, like linear, first order, but any dimension, any number of controls. No. The next order, the fourth order, even for two dimension, is done only partially. So you can find your ways for very special brackets to get a good curves also. Because then you have to balance more. In particular, what is done well is the bracket which you obtain using hyper elliptic curves. And I don't want to touch this theory. With hyper elliptic curves which have more something like that, okay? So you have balance a lot and realize with hyper elliptic curve you have realized high order bracket, okay? But very special. These curves like that, you have a plus, minus, so you might kill third order term, you can kill fourth order term, but there will be only very, very special brackets. So for particular systems, non-commutative, that's called chain system sometimes, where only very special brackets are, with a lot of symmetries are non-zero, it works well. But universal picture starts to be to reach for our force. Maybe I stop here because it's natural. And then the next lecture I will start a regular development of this endpoint map and introduce some other tools and study controllability problems.